Bible Fellowship, Carnegie, Princeton, and Hubble Fellowship. And so she moved to Carnegie as a Hubble Fellow. And soon after that, she already was offered a permanent position at the Carnegie. And so that's where she is since then. Directly, and it's a great pleasure for us to have her here today to give a talk on the nature of the intergalactic medium, and what this has to say as or tell us about the photo ionization of the surrounding galaxies. Please.
Thank you. Today I'm going to talk to you about cosmic calorimetry, and I'm going to go through a little bit of the history of it, sort of a deep ancient history. So some of the experts in the audience bear with me, because I really want you to understand why I think this is a big deal, and why we think we might be in crisis territory. So 2001 is, the WMAP satellite is launched, and this is really sort of the beginning of this era of what we now call precision cosmology. And of course, now we're very well entrenched in this era of precision cosmology. We're measuring cosmological parameters, thanks now to the Planck satellite, which maybe some of you here are involved with. which one of these plots did you not like? From things like supernova, from the cosmic great background, of course, from the line of the forest and baryon acoustic features in the galaxy distribution. But it's important to remember that even though we're now very firmly entrenched in this era of precision cosmology, before really WMAP, just before, a few years before, there were real debates about basic cosmological parameters. So not there's just many sigma discrepancies between things like the baryon density. What I'm showing here is just some early Lyapunov spectra, which is now from the late 90s, where people were looking at the relative value of deuterium to regular hydrogen. This is from the Girls and Teitler 1998 paper. And you see their value for the baryon density was much different than another group that was arguing based on this system for a very low cosmic baryon density. So I only put this issue in particular has subsequently been resolved, but I only put this up to remind us that we haven't been in this era of precision cosmology for very long. And it, when there are discrepancies, we should solve them and pay attention. So people basically knew immediately upon observation of the first high redshift quasars in the 60s that the universe was highly ionized. And this is this classic Gunn and Peterson 1965 paper. And they basically reasoned that if the baryon density was high and the universe was not highly ionized, the optical depth from Lyman alpha emitted by one of these early quasars, this is just a table from an early paper by Schmidt, the ionizing radiation coming shortward of Lyman alpha from a distant source would at some point on its trajectory be redshifted to the Lyman alpha frequency and be resonantly scattered. And you should see just pure absorption shortward of Lyman alpha. And the fact that they did not see pure absorption, the fact that they saw this forest of absorption features shortward of the Lyman alpha line, immediately told them that the universe was highly ionized. Here, of course, I'm just showing the SDSS progression of the Lyman alpha forest. This is Lyman alpha line in a quasar spectra going from around redshift of 5.7 up to redshift around 6.5. And you can see that as you go to higher and higher redshifts, that forest becomes thicker and thicker and thicker, and you start seeing less and less transmission shortward of the Lyman alpha line. And of course, this is what we think may be telling us the sort of the signpost of the end of reionization. Now, interestingly, I didn't realize this until recently, Bacall and Salpeter and Siam and Rees also invented the CGM sort of around 1965. So we think about the CGM as a relatively new kind of concept, but it's actually, like most things, just being reinvented. So the Lyman Alpha Forest is something that we think is very well understood theoretically, and of course it's very well characterized observationally. You get high resolution, high single choice spectra of distant quasars or even our distant galaxies, and you can see this forest of absorption features and measure the properties of that those absorbers extremely accurately. And we think we understand this theoretically. So what do I mean when I say this is well understood theoretically? So first of all, there are many different models to try to explain this absorption early on. And what we now understand to be the origin of these absorption features, just the neutral hydrogen intervening in sort of a fluctuating intergalactic medium between us and those distant quasars. And that was actually an insight that came directly from the first cosmological hydrodynamic simulations. And so at that time, let me continue why I think it's well understood. So here is just an actual quasar spectrum, and these are little snippets from that spectrum showing zoom-ins of little absorption features. Now the normalized flux is just given by 1 minus e to the minus optical depth, and the optical depth is something we understand, it's just the recombination of hydrogen. So it's just going like the density squared times the temperature to a weak power, that's just coming from the recombination coefficient. So this is hydrogen, we get it, we understand it really well. When in the late 90s people ran sight lines through these early cosmological hydro calculations, what they found is that they could produce hydrogen absorption lines that looked very, very similar to those that were observed. Now, by the standards of modern simulations in many sort of sectors, this would already be victory. But by the standards of the late 90s, where people were very, very skeptical of these calculations, this was not enough. And so really, you couldn't just say that, okay, we matched, the observations were done. We had to really understand why these observations matched. And that was actually, I think, one of the tremendous successes of these early cosmological hydro calculations. So why is this a success? So the reason that this works is because of this diagram here. So this diagram is sort of like a Rosetta Stone for a lot of what I'm going to be talking about, so we need to pay attention. This is just showing, in a smooth particle hydrodynamic calculation, the relationship between temperature and density, your column density, of our particles. Okay? So what you have is this very narrow sequence, this linear sequence in temperature and density at very moderate to low overdensities. Okay? Then you have very, very high density gas. These are galaxies. Then up here you have what we call the warm-hot intergalactic medium. But the Lyman Alpha Forest is arising, these are low column density hydrogen absorption lines, it's arising from this portion of the diagram. So this is moderate overdensity, and it has this very, very nice relationship between temperature and density. So the temperature goes like the density to some power that we can measure in these calculations. And then the optical depth, since we can put the temperature just in terms of the density, just is a function of the density. So this is extremely powerful because now we have an observable that just depends on minus height density. Okay? And now strictly speaking, this is the gas density, but because we're in this very low to moderate overdensity regime, that gas density traces the dark matter density. And at the basic level, there are details to the story, but at the basic level, that is why we can use the Lyman Alpha Forest as a cosmological probe. So, what sets up this narrow relationship? Why does that happen? So the reason you get this linear relationship is because you have essentially a balancing. You have a balancing of cooling from the expansion of the universe and heating. And that heating is partly coming from cosmology, but mainly it's coming from the photoionization heating of all the quasars and all the stars that are forming in galaxies and escaping out to these moderate overdensities and photoheating that gas, photoionizing and heating that gas. And so just a snippet from one of these early papers. This is from this 1996 Hernquist et al. Paper. This is a, what is the, called the column density distribution in the Lyman-Alpha forest. And so this is the number density of Lyman-Alpha forest absorption lines as a function of redshift interval and as a function of column density as a function of column density. And you can see that at these relatively low column densities, you have this very nice sort of linear relationship. And in this early paper, they point out, and if you bear with me, I will read this whole quote, the column density distribution alone may be a rather blunt test, serving largely to constrain the parameter combination J over omega baryon squared, where J is the flux density, within a specific theory. However, one can check to see whether the required evolution of J is physically reasonable. And once this parameter combination is fixed, there is not much freedom to adjust the predicted higher order properties of the Lyman-Alpha forest. Now that's a, you know, that's from 1996, or the early 1995. But essentially, it is this balance that's going to be the central feature of what I'm going to talk to you about today. This balance is why we can use the IGM as a calorimeter. Okay, how have people used this as a tool for precision cosmology? And this is something that Dr. Hanawi's group is actively working on. These are some early calculations of just measuring the power spectrum of the Lyman-Alpha forest flux. And what I'm just showing here, you don't need to read the points on this diagram, but what you just need to know is that these are different cosmologies. And in the early days, people compared the data from various cosmological simulations run with different, very different cosmologies in different cases to try to estimate what, you know, what type of parameter estimation, how much discriminating power you could get from the Lyman-Alpha forest. And of course, that was just the power spectrum, and there's more recent work on this. But now people can actually detect the baryon acoustic feature in the Lyman-Alpha forest itself. And so it's because of these nice properties of the Lyman-Alpha forest that you can actually use it as a precision cosmological tool. And so how do these simulations work? So I'm just going to show a movie of a cosmological hydro calculation. It's sort of required. But what I'm showing is the evolution of the temperature from very, very high redshift, redshift 20, all the way down to redshift 0. Here's sort of the peak of star formation. We're zooming through. Pink is very high temperature. Purple is very low temperature. And you can start to see stars going off, galaxies blowing bubbles around, around themselves of hot gas as they form stars. Those stars go supernovae and put their energetic and metallic contents into the intergalactic medium. You see that there's a strong temperature evolution of these boxes. So why do I say, what do I mean when I, say you can use the IGM as a calorimeter? So really it's an instantaneous calorimeter. So in a real calorimeter, you have some reaction that occurs in solution. You got a thermometer. And if that reaction is in some type of a insulated cup, the thermometer just records the heat change because it's trapped in those in that surroundings. In a very similar way, you have some reaction occurring in the baryons. You have stars going off. You have quasars driving winds. The temperature or the photoionization rate can increase. And the Lyman-Alpha forest will instantaneously record that increase, or relatively instantaneously on cosmic times. Of course, if you need the ionization fronts to propagate, they propagate steeply. Okay, so that is what I mean when I'm going to talk about it as a calorimeter. And an example of this is galactic superwinds. So I'm just showing some old calculations of, in the bottom panel, showing density. In the top panel, I'm showing temperature. And these are slices through here, redshift 3 calculation, where I'm showing different strengths of this of these supernova winds. So on the right-hand side of this diagram, the supernova winds are being driven very powerfully, and you can see that drives big hot bubbles into the gas immediately surrounding these nodes where galaxies form. And on the left, you see I have very weak feedback, so very weak superwinds. And so you can see that doesn't really perturb the temperature much at all. The density, remarkably, is very little perturbed by these effects at these redshifts. As you go over cosmic time, you have more changes as you accumulate these feedback effects. Okay, so how do we compare theory to data? we have some value of the cosmological parameters, and we have some value of this photoionization rate as a function of time. We know something about the way stars and quasars evolve, and so we can measure this gamma, this photoionization rate, hydrogen photoionization rate, as a function of redshift. We compare that and put that into our cosmological calculation. Of course, these parameters govern the density structure of the forest, and this gamma governs that temperature-density relation. We can evolve it forward, and then we can predict what the Lyman Alpha forest should look like as a function of redshift. So what are our main tools here? So I showed you the power spectrum, which I won't be talking about today, but the main tools, and I also showed you an early column density distribution, but we have two sort of main tools that I'm going to be talking about in detail. So you have the mean opacity of the forest, and that's just the average absorption along your sight lines. And that just tells you kind of something about the gross properties of the forest, so how thick and how thin how it is. And that's sort of, you know, this is kind of what when Gavin Peterson were looking at the first quasar spectra and seeing light coming through, that's sort of what they were thinking about, was this mean opacity. How is this mean opacity not 10 to the 5? You can also cast it in terms of the mean flux decrement. The column density distribution measures the fine grain structure and clumping of the forest. So this tells you essentially what scales you have, you have structure on the forest. So do you have most of the opacity coming from very, very high column density systems, or do you have zillions of very low column density systems, which is providing the bulk of this opacity? Okay? And of course, this depends on the recombination rate, and this depends on the photoionization rate, and on the temperature in the way that I showed you earlier. Now, measuring gamma is hard. This is a very difficult measure to make. You need to measure the hydrogen ionizing flux with time, and there's various different ways that people have tried to do it. People have tried to use the quasar proximity effect, so tried to measure the ionizing bubbles of quasars and see where that fades into the background, knowing something about the flux of the quasar, the ionizing luminosity of the quasar, where those match tell you something about gamma. You can measure recombination radiation on the outskirts of galaxies, and I'll talk about that a little bit later in the talk. Another possibility is to match this mean opacity. So you run a cosmological hydro calculation, and you match this mean value of the opacity, and that tells you the amplitude of this background, okay? Provided you've got your temperatures correct in that calculation. And the other way to measure gamma is indirect, but you can just make an estimate of the ionizing photons that leak out of galaxy-forming, stars forming in galaxies, and quasars. And if you can, in this method, you propagate those photons through some type of intergalactic medium. And this method is really kind of most famously done maybe by Hartmann-Dow in 1956, and subsequent many different works that tried this way to measure it. Okay? Now in 2001, our era of precision cosmology, everything seemed to line up. So, if you calculated the column density distribution from a cosmological hydro calculation and compared that to the data available at the time, these were STIS data, and then used, those cosmological calculations came from using a value of gamma coming from this method, counting up the photons from known sources, amazingly, everything seemed to line up. So the value of the hydrogen column density distribution, assuming that gamma from known sources, looked remarkably similar to the data. So this is like, declare victory, go home, work on something else, improve your code, test your observers about this. But there's been 10 years of sort of new and improved observations, and sort of many billions of dollars devoted to improving the census of ionizing photons. In particular, there have been lots of quasar surveys, there have been lots of galaxy surveys, the Madow plot, the star formation rate, density of the universe. You guys have seen this a billion times. And in the intervening period, people have done new and improved cosmological hydro calculations, and they've measured gamma that way. I'm just showing here gamma as a function of redshift, These dots show different different surveys that measure it from the measure gamma from the opacity of the forest. Here is a revised calculation from Hart and Madow that was published in 2012 that includes a contribution from quasars and from galaxies. You can see all of these new, here I'm just showing a co-moving Rydberg, one Rydberg emissivity as a function of redshift, and again divided up into quasars and galaxies. And so all of these improvements led to an improved value, or at least a new value, of gamma. And one of these major improvements was the building of the cosmic origin spectrograph. Okay, so this can now measure all of these data can be measured much more accurately. Many, many more lines, it's a much more sensitive spectrograph. Okay, so let's see how these simulations with these new this new gamma fares with respect to the data. And of course, this is what I call the photon under production crisis. If you calculate the hydrogen column density from these simulations using the revised Barton-Madow background, compare it with the latest observations of the column density coming from Charles Danforth and collaborators, you find that there is a huge mismatch. Okay, so this was very unexpected. If you look at the significance based on the error bars of this mismatch, it is tremendous. It's far greater than changing your feedback prescription. It is far greater than most of the changes that you're likely to make. Looking at the mean decrement, you can see that the mean decrement between the Hart-Madow, the old value of gamma, and the new value of gamma is changed by a factor of 2, and it's many sigma discrepant with the value that is observed. And so what does this tell you? This tells you that you require a significantly higher input of energy or ionizing flux than is accounted for in Hart and Madow 2012. And just to give you a visual impression of what this looks like, this is what this is now the neutral hydrogen column density. So bright here doesn't mean emitting, it means dense. This is a snapshot of our simulation. This is now redshift of 0.1, and that's very important, using the Hart and Madow 2012 background. And you see you have all of these nice filaments, and there's lots of gas, lots of neutral gas, compared to what we need to explain the observations. And you can see most of that structure is gone.
What do you see to explain the observations? That's the absorption.
That is the absorption, yeah. So that is to explain the pink points. I put these green points on here just to show earlier measurements from STIFs. It could have been that when you went to COS, you saw some huge downturn, or it could have pushed things in a different direction, but you just saw this continuing upward as you expect from the simulations. So this is a big surprise, and it's a big difference. So, you know, in this era of precision this and precision that, I mean, you know, that looks like we've got some big accuracy issues potentially. You know, not in the cosmological parameters, but certainly in gamma, which is kind of a quasi-cosmological parameter. So what's happening? So here I'm showing the column density distribution again. I'm showing in red the Hart and Madow 2001 column density distribution. In black, I'm showing the 2012 distribution. So you can see that the 2001 background isn't perfect, but it's certainly much better. And what I'm showing here in blue is just multiplying the Hart-Madow 2012 background by a factor of 5. So we're just saying gamma has to be higher by a factor of 5. And in fact, that is a good fit to the observations. So where is that factor of 5 in ionizing flux? And where does that come from? Okay, so basically, the column density distribution goes, the column density of H1 goes like 1 over gamma. And the slope of that column density distribution is about minus 0.75. So a factor of 3 difference here translates to a factor of 5 difference in gamma. Okay, so that's just where those numbers come from. And so this is the value that we need. This black line shows you the Hart-Madow 2012. This dashed line shows you the 2001 value, which you can see is pretty close. This long dashed line shows you an alternate measurement from Fauchet-Guiguerre 2009, so you can see they also get a pretty low value of gamma at redshift. And this dotted line, I'll talk about this dotted line in a minute. Okay, so this is a pretty significant.
Is it part of the point that those models are tuned to get the high redshift forest, right? But they haven't been tuned to get the low redshift forest?
Yeah, so I'm going to go through all these things. And so they have not been tuned to get the low redshift forest, right? When we first saw this, we said, okay, Piero, Francesco, like, you messed up, you goofed. So tell us what we can change, because you don't have enough photons at low redshift in your, and that's the first thing we did, was to say, you're messed up at low redshift. So what do you have to play with? All you have are the, in this model, all you have are the quasars and the galaxies. And when we pushed, they pushed back. They pushed back really hard and said, look, we can't make our escape fractions that high, we can't make our quasars that high amplitude. So I'm going to go through now all the things we thought could be messed up and where I think it stands today. Okay? Yeah?
You initially described Parker Mandel as a simple counting exercise. Now, will you go through what changed? Was it the daring extrapolation or the actual counting of things you see?
So I am going to go through all the things that changed, but that's key. So it was sort of it was mostly in what we see. It was mostly the observational changes. They did improve the radiative transfer, or they changed the radiative transfer, whether or not that's improvement. Okay.
These redshifts and increased patterns that are right in charge of the horizon.
That's right. So exactly. I mean, so we checked it because we thought, okay, what's wrong here? So we did check that. So the radiative transfer doesn't totally matter, but if you do change the path length by a factor of two, you get, you know, you only get a 40% or something change. You don't get very much of a change. So that's exactly right. So what can you fix? Okay, so it could be the quasar SED. So Joe will recognize this figure, I think. The Hart-Mandel 2012 SED was a little bit harder than the Hart-Mandel 2001 quasar SED. So if you put more ionizing photons in your intrinsic quasar SED, then you can get more ionizing photons out. And so this is a very nice compilation by Lisa et al, 2015, who many of you probably know, comparing her value of the SED in blue here, the composite quasar SED, with various values in the literature, including this line here, which is the Hart-Mandel. So you can see that if you change your quasar SED, you can change things by a little bit, definitely. So what does that mean, a little bit? Kind of means like 20%. It doesn't mean a factor of 5. Maybe you can change it by 30%, I don't know. but it's not gonna get you the whole way there. Maybe this is part of the story. But then you have to ask, what the consistency is across the wavelength range. So you can't violate the infrared background, you can't violate the X-ray background. Okay. So that's maybe part of the story. So this certainly helps, but it's just not enough to solve this issue. What about the quasar luminosity function? So maybe there's just more quasars than we think. So in fact, from 2001 till 2010, the quasar luminosity function actually came down. It came down by about a factor of 2. And that is certainly part of the issue. Rob?
Sorry, can I ask a question to you on your SEDs? I mean, there are all these lines which carry an enormous amount of total energy with the flux, and they're all neglected, as I understand, to be analytically fixed, right?
That's right. That's right. So you approximate it as a power law. So, yes, I mean, that basically works, right? but in any event, when you're changing this SED, the point is just that the SED alone, it helps you, but we need a lot of help. We've got a factor of 5. So by cosmological standards, this is just enormous amount of energy. Okay. What about this quasar luminosity function? So the quasar luminosity function had been going down. The actual value, with the new SED and the value from the quasars, hadn't changed actually very much since sort of the late 90s. But this QSO emissivity had come down, and so that certainly goes into, that's part of it. Some authors have argued that actually there could be, that this revision downward is incorrect. In fact, it really is a factor of two higher. So a factor of two, that helps. That helps a lot. So depending on what this Poisson luminosity function actually is at redshift zero, this is now just compilations of different Poisson luminosity functions, Krum et al. 2009, Cowie et al. 2009, this is from Hopkins et al. 2007. You can see at least their quoted error bars are very small, so not a factor of two. But the point is that this is super easy to measure Poisson luminosity functions. I mean, it really is in this day and age. Like, you're not talking about measuring, modes from gravity modes from inflation. You're talking about counting up quasars. Like, we can do this, okay? So we should. We should do it to better than a factor of two. What about galaxies? So one of the biggest changes in the Hartman-Dow 2012 background is that the escape fraction has been dramatically reduced. So basically, the escape fraction goes like 1 plus e to the 3.4 power, which is huge. So the escape fraction at redshift zero is like zero, okay? And as a result, it's 10 to the minus 4, right?
That comes in because in the counting, you actually count photons just longer to find off of the non-ionizing photons, but you won't know which.
That's right. So you have to know, what you measure is a star formation rate density, and then you have to convert that into an ionizing photon flux. And that requires knowing the escape fraction. So this escape fraction has come down. Why has it come down? It hasn't come down because people hate ionizing photons escaping galaxies. It's come down because people have looked for it and measured it and found it to be very, very small. So in many cases, there are notable exceptions, but there are many cases where people have tried to find high escape fractions in large samples of galaxies and they keep finding nothing. Okay? There are some galaxies that have high escape fractions, but they're extremely rare. So if you want them to output all of the UV, all the ionizing flux, there's just not enough of them to do it. So in order for this to be the solution, you need to boost the escape fraction to around 15%, and this is compared to limits less than 5% that we have now for the whole population, and you need the Poisson luminosity function to be boosted by a factor of two. So galaxies must dominate locally. Now you're just thinking, okay, fine. I actually call this the Volkswagen solution because it just means that the emission is much, much higher than we're measuring, right? So that's so let's not blame Hartman-Dow so quickly. We're all tempted, as you know, to say, okay, like I just got it wrong. Gamma is just much higher, and try next time. Okay, so here again, this is the value of gamma. Here is that line of the escape fraction of 15% that I said that we needed. When you tell somebody that you need an escape fraction generically from galaxies of 15%, someone who's measuring these things, they just tell you to go away. But anyway, that's one of the things that we thought we needed.
That's what you need at high redshift.
Right, maybe it is, right? So maybe the Volkswagen solution is really it, okay? We're just not measuring the right thing. This dot here is very interesting. So this dot shows the measurement of gamma at low redshift from galaxies in the local universe. And this is a technique that actually Sinyaev talked about in the late 60s. Basically, it's in this paper, the interaction of the medical active UV background with galaxies. So what you do is you take very, very deep radio integrations of local galaxies, and you measure the neutral hydrogen as well as you can to as large a radius as you can, and then you compare that with the H-alpha flux. So you have an ionizing photon impinging on the outside of the galaxy. That ionizing photon ionizes hydrogen, it recombines, and you emit some H-alpha. You get line alpha, but H-alpha is even easier. These are measurements of two galaxies where Adams et al. Have actually made this measurement. They've compared this H-alpha flux to their radio max, and this is the value of gamma that they infer from that. And just because this is kind of a messy figure, I just wanted to show you theoretically what this looks like if you have a ball of gas and you irradiate it on one side, or a disk of gas, and you irradiate it on one side. Here I've got some big bright ionizing source over in the corner, and this is just this is now aligned out the map, but HF is even easier. You get sort of one side of these things to start lighting up. That's just the recombination. That's just fluorescence from the recombination radiation. Okay, so this is very, very straightforward. If that value of gamma is correct, that is quite quite alarming, I would say. And we'll go through that. Okay. So what about other things? Okay, so I went through what we need to do to quasars, what we need to do to galaxies, but maybe the quasars and the galaxies are actually right, and there are some other sources. So unfortunately, Christoph Kramer had to have a conference to go to, so he isn't here today. But blazars are quite a nice way to heat the low-density intergalactic medium. They emit very, very high-energy photons. They pair produce off of the background, and then they create a plasma instability, which, as it dissipates, heats the low-density IGM. And it heats preferentially at low densities because it's just a fixed energy per particle. So this is that temperature-density relation. This is now at redshift, this is at redshift 3. This is that normal temperature-density relation we see in the simulations, and you can see that it's going positively here, temperature versus density. And if you put this blazar heating, suddenly you're heating the low-density regions, and that causes this upturn in the temperature-density relation, particularly at low density. So this is a very controversial model. There are some observations that indicate that maybe it's true, but those observations are very controversial. But it's quite interesting, and it's giving us something that we need, because we need heat in the intergalactic medium. So do they work? So we ran some calculations of the Hartmann-Dow 2012 background. We ran our simulations using Christoph and Ewald and Fulber's temperature density relation. We used that blazar model, this on the right hand side, and we asked how that would change the confidence density distribution. And as expected, you heat the intergalactic medium and you suppress, you make the lineup force thinner. So that black line goes to this light blue line, which is sort of okay, and this red line goes to this dark blue line. So it's doing better, but still it looks like it's not quite enough if you take the Hartmann-Dow 2012 background. But that's what blazars do, they do heat. How much extra heat do you actually need? So in order to match things, this is now, this dark blue line here just shows you what happens when we just increase all the temperatures of our particles by a factor of 4. So we just artificially take all of our temperatures and heat them up by no physics, okay? And you can see that brings things down, but because of the weak temperature dependence in the recombination coefficient, if you want to match these data purely by heating, you need to heat the IGM by a factor of 10. It's a lot of heat, okay? So that's what we need. That's just what we need. Now, it could be that something about our simulations is wrong, something about the structure of the IGM in our calculations is wrong, or the cosmology is somehow wrong. So, this beautiful sort of power spectrum that has, galaxies mapping onto the cosmic microwave background, but it's just an accident that the line alpha forest matches in this diagram. I think that we really don't think that this is the case. We do not think that this is the case. This is very well converged in our simulations. It's certainly very important to check this with other calculations, and I'd love to analyze Fulber's new repo runs to check this. I think some people in their group might be doing that. It's worthwhile checking these things, but we don't think there's anything really wrong with the cosmology. In principle, you could have like a warm dark matter type of model that wipes out structure, but it's just hard to see why you would wipe out this structure and then get good matches to the Lyman alpha forest at high redshift. So that's a little disturbing. It could be something really exotic. At the point where we were writing this coaching Piero and Francesco about these quasars and about this galaxy escape fraction, and they just kept on telling us, no, 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 just go away. You know, we don't want to know about this. And so you know that it's like a dark place when you start thinking about dark matter decay. And maybe you can get some heat from these exotic dark matter particles. So this is just a particular model for some X-ray photons that you can get from, this is from Kev Abizadjan, Tansu Dalen, who works with Doug Finkbeiner, has some other model. I mean, you can always cook up a dark matter model that will decay into some sort of bath of low energy photons. It's worth noting that you don't need very much of the dark matter to decay into this. It's like something like 10 to the minus 8 of the dark matter density needs to decay in order to get a value that's consistent with this. So we need better measurements of gamma, and I think we can look to the simulations for some guidance on the sort of emission signature from the ultraviolet background. At high redshifts, we can do this from the ground, but at low redshift, we need space instruments. So this is just a concept for a spacecraft called ISTOS by Chris Martin that would actually measure this, measure gamma directly from looking at emission from the IGM directly, very similar to that scenario type of effect. And I spent a lot of time predicting this back in the days. So now that we can actually do Monte Carlo radiative transfer of 1 alpha in cosmological simulations. It used to be that you could actually only calculate the 1 alpha emission from simple type of geometries. Now we can calculate the 1 alpha emission from the types of geometries we routinely encounter in cosmological contexts. This is a sort of classic figure just showing how the Lyman alpha line comes out of a sort of structure like an isothermal sphere. You get this classic double peak profile that depends on the optical depth because Lyman alpha is resonant, and so it has a hard time getting out of a big cloud of neutral hydrogen. It has to rattle in frequency space to the wings of the line in order to come out. And this is just a 2 megaparsec region from a redshift 2 SPH calculation. I'm showing the gas density on the left and the gas temperature on the right. And here, I'm showing this is the gas density. This is the neutral column density. This is what we're talking about when we're talking about the Lyman alpha forest that I've been discussing. And in principle, you can predict what this patch of the intergalactic medium would look like if you observed it with a Lyman alpha telescope, something like potentially MUSE or on a bigger telescope or in future instruments. This is the emissivity, this is the Lyman alpha map, so incorporating that scattering, and this is just if you put a slit down, what each patch of this diagram would look like in frequency space. So you can see these structures kind of look like a mess in frequency space. If you imagine sort of an IFU that could slice this up, you can start to reconstruct this density profile. Now, of course, this is much brighter near a quasar. So if you put a big bright quasar in the center of this density field, of course, that emission, that surface brightness goes way up. So before it was mostly around this sort of green stuff. Now you're getting up really high because you've got the emission of the quasar. And of course, that is now being detected routinely. This is from a paper that Joe was involved in with Sebastiano Cantalupo showing one of these big quasar lit up nebulae. This is from Chris Mark. I think this is the same, this is your same galaxy, I think, right? And of course, this has been detected for a while now.
What's the observation of it?
This is from the Palomar Cosmic Web Imager prototype. So it's just this galaxy, but seen with another telescope, I think. They've got more frequency coverage. But that big bright thing has just come out recently. So just to go through the logic of photon production crisis, and I have 15 minutes left.
Yeah. Now we have used all 2 minutes. So.
Okay. All right, guys. We're okay. So I just want to give you a sense of like what is the logic here. Okay? Many of you may have decided, okay, Hartley, that was wrong, like I'm turning off, but I want to just go through it with you. So we have 3 essential observations. We have the observation that the Lyman alpha forest is thin, we have the observations of gamma from the external radiation impinging on these galaxy disks, and we have that is low, and we have this counting up of sources done by Hartman-Dowd 2012, and we have that is giving a low gamma. And I'm just going to go through all the permutations, assuming these are either true or false, okay? And I apologize to the colorblind in the audience, but I just realized this is useless to you. So it could be, that the Lyman Alpha Forest observations are wrong? So I think this is essentially ruled out. So if the observations are wrong, then there would be absolutely no crisis because the forest is thick, so gamma is in fact low, so the HF12 value of gamma is perfectly consistent. And these are all these permutations here, okay? This is essentially ruled out. So the observations are very straightforward. They agree across different groups and across different instruments. So I only bring this up for completeness. I think it's very unlikely, okay? So now we're in this case where this is correct. So it could be that Hartman-Dowd are wrong and Adams et al. Are wrong. Okay, in this case, gamma is high. So that means that there aren't enough photons accounted for, and you have to explain why that gamma is low in these in the edges of these disks. There's a factor of five discrepancy between models and observations. So what that implies is that the galaxy escape fractions must be 10 to 15% locally, so why aren't we observing them? We need to find those galaxies. And quasars need to be boosted by a factor of two. Okay? So the escape fraction observations are wrong. You know, the QSO luminosity functions, those old ones have to be wrong, right? So that corresponds to this case. Or you could have extra heating sources. Okay, you need to heat the IGM by a factor of 10. Of course, you could have combinations of these things. So some extra heat, some more ionizing photons. But anyway, if you have more heat, you need a factor of 10 more heat. And this case I think is very interesting. Because if this value of gamma is correct, and it was just an upper limit before, but now they actually have a real measurement, and it comes out to be exactly the same, this is a paper that Juan Usona is working on. If this value of gamma is correct, then you need extra heat. You don't have any more photons, you're done. So that's, I think, quite interesting. Or there could be some exotic source of photons, like dark matter decay. So if these are all correct, if the Lyman Alpha Forest is thin and Hartman-Dowd are correct in their photon accounting, and this value of gamma is low, then you require, then either the Lyman Alpha Forest structure from the simulations is just wrong, or you need extra heating from decaying dark matter or unknown sources. So as they say in Bavaria, Shyamalan. And I do want to just go on to for a few minutes, if I have a little bit more time, I do want to talk about the IGM. So I talked about the IGM at what I'm going to call cosmic dusk, just because there are these horrible terms, and why not have another? But I do want to talk a little bit about cosmic dawn, because I think it'd be interesting to this audience. So what I think the issue is that the quasars are telling you, these higher-tip quasars are telling you where that von Peterson optical depth is starting to get high. Right, so that's telling you something about the end of what we're thinking reionization is. The electron scattering optical depth from combination to reionization, right? That from Planck, the measurement from Planck, is sort of telling you about this integrated population of sources. Okay? So what I think the issue is that there are hundreds of candidates, galaxy candidates at redshifts greater than 7. There's been hundreds of hours of time invested into getting spectroscopic redshifts of these sources, and there's been very, very few detections. So what is really going on here? So at Carnegie, we always have a sort of go big or go home sort of attitude. And so I just wanted to talk about this survey for a second, which I call the edge of the universe Durchmusterung, which basically what we're doing is we're integrating down to a fixed surface brightness for about 30 candidates, 30 of these detections are these nominal candidates, and trying to see what the actual failure rate is. So not just if we detect the highest redshift object, but actually how many things do we not detect in this sample? Because that is what we need in order to understand if this type of a model is all consistent with the electron scattering optical depth and the quasar Gunn-Peterson drop. And so this is the first detection that we found. So this is just a galaxy. This is a line and alpha detection at redshift of 6.2. This is the associated carbon-4, and this is the associated oxygen-3 line. It's kind of interesting because these objects that people have detected have very high IRAC excesses. It's not obvious that they're galaxies that are being detected. They may be quasars that are being detected, and we don't really know because we don't have deep enough spectra to really see all the metal lines that you might expect from a galaxy population. So I just think this is very interesting. If there are people in the audience who want to talk about this more, I seek labor. So people who are interested in sort of either the modeling side of this or the survey side of this, please let me know. And with that, I will take any questions you have.
Destroyed.
destroying a lot of, you know, potentially star-forming systems, which is very helpful for solving things like the missing satellites problem. In, you know, specifically at what mass, what dwarf galaxy sort of mass and configuration you have to go to, and still, you know, to actually completely photoevaporate it, you know, I'm not sure exactly, you know, depends a little bit on the configuration of the system. I'm not surprised though at the level of the ionizing background. It's much lower than you would get, you know, to photoevaporate those systems. There is some mass where you are photoevaporating things, but you know, you're really talking about the low density tail and the outskirts of galaxy disks. But certainly, you know, the dwarfs are very interesting for a number of reasons.
What about other sources of ionizing photons which are not very exotic, like dwarfs, old stars? I mean, these things would be, they probably don't matter at all at high redshift, but maybe at low redshift.
So, if, you know, so when you, you know, typically that's accounted for at least at some level with the, you know, with the star formation rate decay. So when we're thinking about how many ionizing photons get out, you're really taking, you're integrating up all of that star formation. That is true. It's true that that's the, you know, really it's the high mass stars that are producing the ionizing photons in that case. I think binaries is where you look for more ionizing flux, to be honest. Not so much the white dwarfs, or I mean, you're, and I do think that that could actually, you know, you could have some situation where at low redshift, your, you know, your binary population is evolved enough that you start to suddenly get some extra sort of ionizing oomph, and there is some evidence that at least theoretically that binaries can do more damage than just single stars. We haven't looked at that. Of course, that would just be an overall amplitude. So it's sort of degenerate with this escape fraction. Basically, you now just have kind of, instead of saying the escape fraction is high, you just say that actually the intrinsic SED is higher, basically. So I think that's interesting to look at.
Okay, let's open the discussion by everybody.
So quite a while ago, I looked at escape fractions of Kinyu-Fujita, and what one thing that was notable to us was that because of the nature of like starbursts in the galaxy, the escape fraction over a long period of time doesn't really matter. Mm-hmm. It's really the question of what's the escape fraction during the flash bulb when all the stars are very
right.
Dark. And are the surveys actually measuring that flash bulb moment when most of the...
So this is a great question, right? So you know that there's huge variance in the escape fractions, and so what you see, which is kind of consistent with your prediction, is that some galaxies have super high escape fractions and some have super low. That's at high redshift now. At low redshift, you know, the galaxies that seem to have, one galaxy in the local universe that has a somewhat high escape fraction is sort of a freak. And whether or not it's a freak in the right direction, you know, I'm not sure, but this is, I think, exactly the point is what is happening in these galaxies? You know, should there not be a huge, massive Hubble program to actually really nail down this question? You know, like, should we keep looking at clusters, all due respect to the cluster lovers among you, okay? Or should we, you know, getting gamma, and this is now a sort of quasi-cosmological parameter that we can do a lot better on. So you know, I think that's a really good point. When, you know, why are these escape fractions so low everywhere, and so stochastic. And I think that John Peter has some nice calculations of escape fractions too. I don't know if he's in the audience.
Yeah, that's at the high redshift.
Yeah, that's a very high redshift. But still, the basic principles of, you know, this huge variance.
So what we find is that at the peak of star formation, there's so much dense gas in the galaxy that the escape fraction is pretty low. So even though you're producing more ionizing photons, they don't get out.
Right.
But I think the other binaries should help because they produce ionizing photons later with supernova people and that's straight away dense gas. You would have more ionizing photons in that case. Yeah.
So first double or first two?
Go ahead. I just want to comment that given the approximate prescription of EIGM by Hans McDowell, their values should always be taken with a grain of salt and accurate to a factor of two, but not much more than that.
Well, so I think that's the thing. If you're worried about the radiative transfer, we did exactly this exercise of increasing the mean free path by a factor of two just to see how it would change, right? And it didn't actually change our results very significantly. But I mean, it's, you know, your point is well taken. How, you know, cumulatively, how is this, you know, this simple radiative transfer actually affecting things? At these low redshifts, it really is this effect that Joe alluded to before. You're rising, you know, your means and path is associated rising, so it's less of an effect at these redshifts. So a lot of your intuition from redshift 2 and 3, you know, some of it holds, and then you know you got to check the other things. But that was certainly one of the things we would really check.
So there's also another photon under production crisis at high redshift, which is that, you know, just if you look at the galaxies that we observe, there's not enough photons per baryon to basically reionize the universe or peak universe on the high redshift. And so the trick there is just to continue to extrapolate down the galaxies that we not only can't see, but probably can never hope to see. Why can't you just do that at low Z? Of course, we're much more sensitive locally, but why can't I just continue to extrapolate down the luminosity function, continue to lower my escape fraction?
Yeah, so it's just that there's just not as much, you know, high redshift, you just have more oomph in your low mass luminosity, your low mass mass function than you do at low redshift. So we just don't have, you know, you just don't have the star formation to play with at low redshift in those little galaxies where you're just making it up at high redshift. So, doing the best you can is what I mean by making it up.
But you're saying, you're saying there's just not enough star formation for us.
Yeah, at least that's, you know, that's what we think at present. I mean, because even if you make the escape fraction super high, you know, you have to go, you know, just way down. And so you start to have to populate the missing satellite problem to get the right ionizing flux.
I have a question. So Glenn, one thing about the dark matter annihilation is potentially efficient heating source. I mean, we now have good constraints on the annihilation cross-section from Transas experiments and other things. And you did it in a very low density environment. The annihilation rate was confronted with the density. Is this really an appreciable rate?
No. So I think it's just the idea that for the current, particularly the annihilation mechanism at the ranges that it's been probed, you know, the answer I think is no. But it's just to say that there could be some exotic physics in, you know, in this region that we don't understand. So that particular mechanism I think is possibly ruled out. I'm not exactly sure if let's see. I just was gonna go back to this diagram here. You can't really read this, I apologize. This is from Tansu Dalen, who's working on sort of the types of models that they use to describe the Fermi bubbles, which are kind of ruled out. But here is the UV to X-ray flux, and this is from a sort of part of the downside of the model. It's sort of consistent. These are the upper limits that people have. It sort of goes below the limits that people have. So I think you can cook up dark matter models that will do this if you need it. If we rule out all the other sources, then you're going to be left with
the
dark matter.
Sure, but this razor would tell you, let's look at the physics we know, then have
some
symmetry, which is
right.
And a big trouble from the latest.
This is why this is subsection 5 of our paper, because 1, 2, 3, and 4 are all the things that we know. And I think that's the thing, is in this era of precision cosmology, don't we owe it to ourselves to, you know, really get things like the quasar luminosity function as a function of redshift, the escape fraction as a function of redshift, gamma as a function of redshift, you know, we really owe it to ourselves to get those very precisely, similarly to the cosmological parameters. I mean, the factor of 2 is, you know, 20th century astronomy, like, we need to get into the next century.
Yeah, I wanted to return to your truth table. Let's presume all 3 pieces of observable information are correct.
Right. And
then you resort to postulating a far higher
temperature. Right.
Let me just accept that there's some magic.
Lasers, right? So Christoph would say basic lasers. Not magic, it's cosmic.
Lasers are 4 by magic.
Okay.
So is there nothing, if the ideal temperature is really factor 10 higher, are there not? Are there independent constraints on the ideal temperature that kind of get in trouble?
Right, so then you kind of want to look at the Doppler widths and the metal lines. And so that's where, you know, that's where you would start to see big differences in the sort of cascade of ionization. So I don't, you know, at this point, it doesn't seem that the temperature is a factor of 10 higher. Actually, when you look at the Doppler widths, you know, simulations are not great at getting the distribution of Doppler widths sort of correct compared to the observations. But there is a shift to higher, but it's not a factor of 10 shift, so you don't see some huge change in the Doppler widths. But there are independent sort of constraints on the temperature. You just want to look at different ionization states of the gas, and you want to look at these thermal widths.
Is that a final question?
Yeah.
You are so.
Is this the right slide that you? If I understand it well, then the usage of the Lyman alpha torus is coming from how you intersect with this cosmic spaghetti, right? So how much wiggle room is there in making the spaghetti thicker and thinner for the constraints that you have on it? I mean, if I take the spaghetti and I make it a bit thicker, the density will go down to the same amount of baryonic mass.
So you're saying how much room is there in the cosmology?
Yes, basically your first point.
So you know, this would be a huge surprise because it really has to kick in at low redshift. It really can't be something, you know, at high redshift, the Lyman alpha torus seems to do an excellent job. So, I was talking to Danielle this morning, and he, you know, can predict the Lyman alpha torus within 5% from a collisionless simulation, right? So, I think it would be very, very surprising if that were the case, which is why I put it in this decaying dark matter. Like, this would be very, very bizarre scenario, and I don't think there's very much wiggle room. You could have, some warm dark matter, but again, it's hard to understand why that would not perturb the, you know, sort of cosmic noon in the Lyman alpha torus, which actually does an amazing job in all the probes that we know. So we think there's something interesting here with counting up the sources. And that you can actually, it's actually very tractable, but it's a big issue. It's a factor of 5. It's not sort of like a 20% issue.
Yeah.